Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Dr. Kelly Heim, and it is my great pleasure to introduce today's guest speaker, Dr. James Greenblatt. Dr. Greenblatt is an integrative psychiatrist with over 20 years of clinical experience in adult and child psychiatry. He is the founder and medical director of Comprehensive Psychiatric Resources in Waltham, Massachusetts. He has written two books on the use of nutritional modalities for mental health. And in today's presentation, he will provide a concise overview of lithium, an essential mineral and one of the most intriguing substances in psychiatry. He will share his expertise on nutritionally relevant doses and how to use lithium properly as a dietary supplement. Please send your questions at any time through the question and answer box, and they will be addressed at the end of the talk. Welcome, Dr. Greenblatt.
Great. Thanks, Kelly. It's good to be here. And I do need to say that low-dose nutritional lithium is probably one of the more exciting supplements that I have found in my practice of over 20 years, and really excited about kind of sharing that information today. I think the webinar will be relatively short, and we'll have plenty of time for questions. We're so focused on lithium as a medication that we forget that it is a mineral. It is a mineral that's been looked at, you know, for centuries, first discovered in the 1800s. In the early 1920s, lithium was actually added to soft drinks, and these drinks were advertised for prevention of hangovers. And they were clearly marketed as use following drinking episodes. The history gets more interesting where lithium was then started to be used for a salt substitute. So lithium chloride was put in salt shakers, and what happened, which I think is the beginning of giving lithium a frightening name, was there were some kind of toxic overdoses from too much lithium chloride in the salt shaker as a substitute for sodium chloride, and lithium was kind of put in this dangerous realm. And then it was in the 1940s and 50s where a psychiatrist discovered in his animal experiment lithium is very calming. And then in the 1970s, it was approved as a medication. I think for those historians in the audience, it is somewhat interesting that it took over 20 years with good available data for this medication to be approved for treatment. And now there's increasing interest in looking at lithium, which we'll talk about low-dose micrograms of lithium as a preventative agent and as a nutrient with a daily requirement. When you look at your multivitamin package and you see a list of ingredients as they're getting more complicated, you see a large list of trace minerals. But one of the things that people forget, because lithium is such a light mineral, its concentration is actually much higher in the human body than many of these trace minerals used in multivitamin mineral preparations. So this is concentration per billion atoms in the human body, and you see that lithium is higher than many of the trace minerals that we supplement with on a daily basis. The history of lithium is also kind of dotted with these magical powers of lithium water and lithium springs. So these are a few around the country that have noted high amounts of lithium with kind of health claims going back to the Indians. There are many, many others around this country and around the world of high lithium water being associated with health. So what we want to try to understand is why this medication, this trace mineral, how it might work and be helpful for many different applications in psychiatry, and what we need to do. If we take animals and we put them on a low lithium diet, we have both reproductive problems, dramatically shorter lifespans, there's abnormal lipid metabolism, and there's very clear behavioral abnormalities on many animal species associated with low lithium diets. What's interesting and what we'll be talking about throughout this webinar is the amount of lithium in the diet, and the vast majority of lithium we consume is actually in the water that we drink. So lithium is in the soil. It's taken up by plants. Its highest concentrations are eggs and grain products. Then the water supply varies dramatically. And what we'll see coming up is communities where the water supply has low lithium, there are different effects, behavioral effects in the community than communities where there's high lithium in the water. When we talk about the highest dietary source of lithium, I don't have the research, but I have read this a couple of places, where the herb thyme has the highest concentration of dietary lithium. The supplementations of low-dose lithium, we use between 500 micrograms up to 10 milligrams as nutritional supplementation. And the medications, when we talk about lithium carbonate, we're talking about dosages of 180-360 milligrams of elemental lithium. So a very wide range of dosages being utilized for many different indications. And the dosage makes it either a poison or remedy, and there's nothing, I think, more appropriate as how to describe lithium. So as a practicing psychiatrist, lithium has somewhat miraculous implications, but it's a medication that I can rarely use nowadays because of this list of side effects. The vast majority of people taking therapeutic dose of lithium have the hand tremors, thirst, nausea, GI problems, and often sedation. As the dosage gets up, our individuals become more sensitive, we have kidney damage and interfering with thyroid function as the most common implications of lithium toxicity. When we discuss some of the case histories in a few minutes, we'll talk about many patients who've done well with their psychiatric difficulties on the medication lithium, but due to kidney damage or complete disruption of thyroid function, they had to stop their medication. So we've talked about the dose dependent kind of effects, and let's really begin to understand, you know, what I think is truly remarkable about this trace mineral. So the research that's been gathered over 20, 30 years looking at the neurochemistry of lithium in both animal and human studies, we can see two very, very reproducible effects of this mineral lithium. One, it protects neurons, and then the other dramatic effect is that we can provide new neuronal growth. And this has come through both basic science research as well as the psychiatric literature, where lithium has been shown to enhance neural connections. So again, John Cade, Australian psychiatrist, was trying to understand actually how if uric acid played a role in some of the symptoms of his patients. And to decrease the solubility of uric acid, he added lithium. And when this combination was injected into animals, guinea pigs were the first, they became calmer and lethargic. And it was then he injected it in himself before he started using this in patients. And that was the beginning of using the medication lithium for major psychiatric illness. There are many different forms of lithium, lithium carbonate, lithium chloride, lithium orotate appears to be the most common capsule. There's some literature showing that it is more easily bound, and there's increased bioavailability. When we use lithium orotate as a supplement, and we'll talk more about, rarely do we have any side effects, and rarely do we get blood levels. I used to check lithium levels when I started anyone on nutritional lithium, and I've only gotten blood levels on those with kidney damage. Here, I just wanted to kind of list the vast kind of array of improving brain health with lithium, and research is supporting kind of moods, behavioral support, aggression, impulsivity, and the newer research is around memory and cognition, and we'll talk a little bit about longevity. And, you know, from the list, you can see my excitement in such a simple mineral having such a profound range of effects on brain health. This is two studies, one looking at an earthworm or a form of worm, and then a human study. But two studies clearly showing that lithium chloride extends the lifespan in this worm. And then this Japanese study looking at large populations, that those with higher lithium concentrations in the water supply had longer lifespan. This is, I believe, some of the most dramatic literature that we have that looks at how to measure kind of behavioral effects and brain effects of the amount of lithium in the drinking water. So we have studies from Texas, the United States, and throughout the world, Japan, Austria, and in England. And in these studies, they looked at a number of different communities. So in Texas, they sampled water supplies in different parts of Texas. And what they were able to show, and this is literature going back to the 1970s and 80s, that those areas with little or no lithium in the drinking water, there were higher crime rates and higher mental health problems than those areas where there was higher lithium in the drinking water. And the studies have been replicated over the years in Asia and Japan and Austria and England. And again, the same findings. If there's communities in the same country with lower levels of lithium in the water, we find more crime and behavioral dysregulation than we would if there's high levels of lithium in the water. This was a study published a while ago with very low dose lithium, looking at 400 micrograms daily. 24 individuals with aggression, impulsivity, and multiple social transgressions, for lack of a better word. And on this, in this four-week course, there was improvement in energy, mood, and disposition. We have many, many studies now looking at low-dose lithium for cognition and memory. The clinical trials range from dosages here in micrograms, 150 to 600 micrograms, to actually dosages from 150 milligrams to 300 milligrams. Here's a study from last year looking, again, 300 micrograms for 15 months in aging population. And those on the lithium group, again, the amount that you might get if you lived in a community with high amounts of lithium in the water, had thyme as an herb daily, that they had improved performance in a mental status examination compared to controls. Again, it was a 15-month study but statistically significant at around 3 months. This, again, more recent study, a double-blind placebo-controlled trial looking at biomarkers in the CSF fluid and lithium supplementation. Here was able to modulate concentrations of the p-tau protein, which has been lots of research done associated with the disruption of brain health. So lowering the concentrations is associated with brain health. Again, on low-dose lithium, we rarely get any side effects. I think we're all familiar with glutathione as the major antioxidant in the brain, and lithium supports the expression of multiple forms of one of the enzymes associated with glutathione, the GST. So I just wanted to share some of the research looking at the wide range of neurochemical theories as to how lithium is helpful. The precise mechanisms are really not clear. We could go through many, many studies looking at different theories, and the reality is we still don't understand how this simple trace mineral could be so effective for mood. A lot of my interest is in essential fatty acids and the relationship between the immune system and the brain, and new research demonstrated that lithium works by affecting the omega-3 fatty acid DHA into a very significant immunological marker with neuroprotective actions. We've all heard of BDNF, which is brain-derived neurotrophic factor. As levels of BDNF goes up, we have improved mood, less anxiety, and less cognitive and memory problems. So lithium has also been associated with elevating levels of BDNF. And here, a study a few years ago looking at this more carefully, again, BDNF being associated, lithium promoting healthy BDNF levels. So I have notebooks with hundreds of articles of varying effects of lithium and brain function. And this I picked up on a plane a couple years ago. It was Discovery Magazine. And it was a front page article. And it was beginning to explore some of the research that's been done for many years and some of the newer research. And I think the title is really the concern for all of us. So lithium, a simple metal, oldest drug, it might protect the brain. One problem, there's no profit in it. So for a pharmaceutical to get FDA approval for more neuroscience research, much of it is pharmaceutically sponsored money. And because lithium is such a simple, inexpensive trace mineral, there's very, very little likelihood that more research will be done on some of these amazing properties. How do you test for lithium? Well, most individuals, if we did a blood test, would have no detectable lithium in our blood supply unless we were taking medications of lithium. So what I have used over the years is a trace mineral analysis in the hair. And these are just kind of two cases. As you can see, lithium is detected in a hair sample on your left as you're reading the screen. And then on the right there with the two arrows, there's actually no detectable lithium in a hair sample of this 20-year-old patient. And this is a slide that I started with, and hopefully I can engage you in more questions in the question and answer period, because we have this essential trace mineral that is in our soil and varies dramatically from area to area around the world and around the country. And we have 50 or 60 years of research looking at both behavior, emotions, cognition, and even longevity. And I think I've been sharing this enough with you, and I will kind of stop there and hopefully can answer your questions. Again, more than almost any nutrient that I've talked about and used, I've been using lithium for about 20 years now and seen a very, very wide range of clinical implications that hopefully we can talk more about.
Thank you, Dr. Greenblatt, and I'd like to thank all of you for attending. I know we have a lot of questions to answer, so we will begin our Q&A session at this time.